Gozaimasu, or Konbanwa. Welcome to the Horror Hangout, a podcast where two bearded film fans watch the 50 best horror movies ever, and we talk about them. My name is Luke Condor with a K, and I'm joined by Mr.
Ben Errington.
How are you, Ben? Are you alright?
I'm alright. I'm feeling good.
Cool.
How are you feeling?
Yeah, a bit lightheaded, like we said before, but I've had some Lucozade. I can feel the electrolytes spilling through my body now, so I feel great.
I wish I had some Lucozade. What flavour of Lucozade have you gone for?
Orange. I don't really like the original one. The plain ready salted flavour.
I love the ready salted flavour. Is it a thing that when you're ill, people always go, oh, do you want some Lucozade? Do you want a little bit of Lucozade?
It works though. Like, there's something about it that does work. People always say you should drink Guinness if you're feeling ill because it's meant to be full of
iron or something. It's full of booze. Guinness is just creamy muck, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
I used to drink Guinness on nights out, like 8 pints of it. And when you think about that, that's horrible, isn't it? That's heavy.
I could only do like 2-3 pints. And then it's bad because you turn into, what's the little creature alien from Futurama called that poos black dark matter?
Oh, yeah, Jesus. Oh, no, don't even talk about it. Through the eye of a needle.
What's his name? I don't know, I can't remember.
I've got no idea.
Okay, so last week's episode we talked about The Evil Dead, and tonight we're talking about Audition. Ben, do you want to tell us about Audition?
Yeah, sure. Audition is a 1999 Japanese horror film based on the novel of the same name, directed by Takashi Miike. I think that's how we're saying this dude's surname. It focuses on recent widower Shigharu Aoyama, whose son suggests he find a new wife. Aoyama agrees and with a friend stages a phony audition to meet a potential new partner in life. After interviewing several women, Aoyama becomes interested in Asami. I'm not doing very well, man. He responds well to him, although they begin to date, her dark past begins to affect their relationship. Dum dum dum.
Yeah, so this is what Empire had to say about it. Those lovely film students over at Empire. The film that broke director Takashi Miike, I think is how it's pronounced. Well, that's what it's on YouTube anyway. Internationally, the film that broke director Takashi Miike internationally doesn't initially seem like a horror film at all. We follow a widower's attempts to get back in the dating game with a younger squeeze via the rather dodgy and disingenuous audition process to which the title refers. And it's only when we realise the object of his desire has literally been waiting by the phone for days, apparently in an apartment empty apart from something, some sort of ominous... something ominous in a sack, that we begin to realise something is very, very amiss. And then there's the foot soaring and the eye needles. Kitty, kitty, kitty. So Rotten Tomatoes rate this 80% fresh. 69% on Metacritic. I also put it out on Facebook, and Johan Chippon said, it is an example of what I call a genre bender, and it's paced so well. Starts as a family drama, leading into a romantic comedy, then a murder mystery psychological thriller, then a surrealist piece, and then flat out torture porn. Smiley face. So what were your initial thoughts on the film?
This was another unsettling viewing, I think.
Yeah.
Another film which was like not straight up horror again.
Yeah.
Again, it's another, well, I guess gender bender, as you said, but genre bender, not a gender bender. Not one of them. I think the horror elements were really unsettling. The use of editing and the use of music, and that was everything that really sort of like gets under your skin. And again, it's something about Japanese horror that does feel really unsettling when it's done right.
That I mean, so everyone who's probably seen this film will say it's all about that last bit, which we'll get onto, but. For me, I really thought that was painful. Like, not in like a this is a bad film sort of way. Painful as in I was feeling the dude's pain. Like, it was horrific. I sort of feel like this film, it's almost set up to be like a practical joke. Like, it could be seen as like, we're going to set it up to be one thing and then we're going to pull the rug from beneath you. And it's actually this horrible, horrible thing. But there's like, I think the thing that saves it a bit and sort of makes it more memorable is that there's sort of running themes and ideas under there that are actually quite deep and quite interesting. But yeah, I thought it was good. I think it was one of the one of the genuinely horrific films we've seen so far on the list.
Yeah, that's what, I think as I've sort of made some notes here, the sort of non-linear narrative,
yeah,
and some bits where it was, you were sort of like, well, was that a dream sequence? Is this a dream sequence? That was kind of like a lot of the unsettling stuff for me.
But there was also
stuff in it where it just seemed completely so far removed from what the film was trying to be. Like there were some really sort of like jaunty, fun-loving little bits where I was just like, where has this come from? Like the whole audition sequence of all the girls sort of auditioning was like,
yeah,
was like cut up like a old, like a really fun montage that you like.
Yeah, like the fashion music.
There was fashion music, yeah.
Yeah, it was. I know what you mean, like, but again, I feel like that was all part, sort of like kind of there to add impact to that final rug pull at the end, because it like it's very sort of straight, like a straight narrative right up to the point where he drinks the whiskey, which we'll get onto again, and then it just suddenly switches, like directing style becomes like a David Lynch film. You're not really sure what's actually happening, and then it ends with this, culminates with this horrible, horrible torture bit.
Yeah, which torture porn wise, just had a lot more impact than anything you see in like the sort of the Western stuff like Saw and Hostel, and which is like it can be gruesome, but this was one of those where you felt it. You felt it a lot more.
To be honest, because it was built up, like you had like literally 60 minutes of just rom-com Japanese drama. Like it just seemed to be, it was an hour of that, and then it suddenly became this horror film.
Yeah, I don't know if personally I'd go as far as saying it like rom-com, only because I think maybe because I knew, you kind of know what's coming because the film precedes itself, doesn't it? You know what the main scene is.
I actually didn't know anything about this film really going in.
To be honest, I only knew about the scene, and I think I've maybe seen the scene before, quite a few years ago. Just stumbled across it maybe on YouTube or something, but I'd seen it before. So it was good to sort of experience it from the start though, but I kind of knew something was coming. So that dread was constantly there for me, and got a footache at the end of it as well.
So the key players in the story, so you've got Shigeru, who's the main dude. He lost his wife at the start of the film, and at the behest of his son, he casually decides to remarry. It's just something you do. I think I'll remarry now. Asami,
I'm ready now.
Asami is the love interest. Let's leave it at that for now. Yasuhisa is Shigeharu's friend, who's a film producer who convinces him to audition these potential wives under the guise of film auditions. And then there's Shigehiko, which is Shigeharu's very well-rounded son, who suggests his dad find a new wife after however long it is. It doesn't actually tell us how long it is.
I think it's 7 years.
Oh, I must have missed that bit.
I think it says 7 years because obviously when we see the son, he's quite young in the initially, and now he's sort of like preteen age. So seven years, I believe.
So we open with the original wife 1.0 dying.
Not funny.
And then it cuts to them fishing, and like it's him and his son fishing, and everything seems happier. And then, I mean, at this point, it just feels like a normal Japanese comedy, romantic drama sort of film, I guess.
Yeah. Like the premise at this point could quite easily be a film starring Jason Bateman and and like, you know, Jennifer Aniston.
Yeah. I was thinking Melissa McCarthy.
He's trying to find a new wife.
Yeah.
Melissa McCarthy. Maybe
I might see this as an American remake with Jason Bateman and Melissa McCarthy.
Yeah. Audition.
Yeah.
I reckon she'd probably pull it off quite well. Yeah.
And then the son is like, look, Dad, I've got a date. You're a bit of a loser nowadays. I think you should start dating again. And then I think this is an important part of the director's idea, is that he very casually says, I'm going to remarry. And I think a lot of this film is about the Japanese male attitude to women and how they perceive, because like so further on the story, so his Shigeharu's friend of the film producer, and then the whole premise is that they're going to audition loads and loads of women under the guise it's a film audition, but then he's going to just choose one of these women and they're going to want to marry him, or they're just going to marry him. I feel like that's a big part of what the director was trying to do.
Yeah, almost like he's treating women like consumables, because they're all sort of like the same age and the same sort of look, aren't they? There's not there are a couple maybe who don't look exactly the same, but most of them look very, very similar in terms of like length of hair and clothing style and everything. So, and there's so many of them. You just think, like, how is he so many, like dozens and dozens of women come to this audition, and he's just like, which one do I want for my wife?
Exactly, yeah. And then, so he read all of their CVs, or I don't know what you call them for an actor.
Resume. Was it called? Just like, I don't know. Was the thing with the headshots and like the portfolio, but that doesn't really make sense.
Whatever that equivalent is for an actor, actress or actor. I don't know if there's any actors there. Mainly actresses, I think. And
there might have been one that snuck in. And he was
might
like,
have been, yeah.
Ooh, hello, I like you.
Yeah. I don't know what it is about this female, but I've got the hots for her.
there was one of the girls who just took her top off willy-nilly, didn't she?
I don't remember any willies.
You would have remembered willies.
I would have, gone, yeah. Oh, well, I remember. You passed the audition.
Congratulations.
You got the job. Yeah.
One of the girls just took her top off like out of nowhere.
And, Weirdly, I don't remember that. I must have.
You don't remember that? What were you doing?
Repressed it.
You must have repressed it, hiding behind a cushion. Oh,
yeah.
That's a scary bit.
Put away those fiery biscuits. Okay, so So he gets a CV for Asami, who is the love interest, and he's like, he's infatuated with this CV, and he pretty much falls in love with her just because she says she's had a tragedy in her past, and I think she's more emotionally mature than the other girls.
He feels a connection with her because, you know, he's had a tragedy in his past, and he's just like, essentially he's reading a little backstory she's written for herself, and he's loving it.
Yeah. So even at the audition, like you said earlier, there's the whole like romantic, it seems like a fashion show sort of music, like a TV show where like it's like kind of it's a bit of a montage, and there's like camera lights flashing and stuff, and they're all like trying to say I'm good because of this, I'm the perfect person for this actress position, or whatever they say. and then he's already made his mind up. He's not even bothered about any of those people.
He makes his mind up. He sees the back of her. He sees when he goes to the toilet, he sees her in the reception reading the book. He sees her from behind. He's like, oh, hello. Who's this then?
That is interesting, because how would he know it's... You must just get the vibe.
He already feels the vibe. He already feels the aura pulling him from across the room.
Yeah, yeah.
Stay well away.
And then, so she comes into audition. She's kind of very quiet, very reserved. And he's like sweating because he's so like, and he's asking these questions. And like you can tell, like his mind's made up. And then, where does it go from there?
It all moves pretty fast, doesn't it? He pretty much does not go out of his way to contact her and ask her out on a date.
Yeah.
And they go, good to get to know each other a little bit more.
Yeah.
And, you know, it moves ever so fast, I've noticed. I mean, how many years would you say between these guys? I mean, he's probably like late 40s, 50.
Yeah.
And you'd say she was like early 20s, mid 20s.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that age gaps in relationships matter, but maybe they do when one of them is possibly a psychopath.
Yeah, yeah.
Possibly.
You should always be careful with any, you know, dating situation. You might die at the end of the date.
I do like the thought of before dating someone getting their resume, and a headshot, and just having a little look over it and going, nah.
It's Tinder, isn't it? I'm pretty sure that's what Tinder is.
Yeah, that's right. But you know, a bit more in depth. You know, Harmony. What's that one called? The Wii Harmony, whatever it's called.
E-Harmony, I think.
E-Harmony, that's it.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm getting a lot of stuff wrong today. I think I need a bit of Lucozade.
You need a bit of Lucozade, mate.
I'm getting the names of stuff wrong.
Yeah. Wee
I need
Harmony.
help.
I like it. That's something else there.
The Wee Harmony. Yeah, that's a different one. That's a totally different website that I haven't got a membership for anymore.
So he goes on this date with Asami, and it goes quite well, I think. She tells him that she works at this bar, and she went to this dance ballet school, and it all seems legit. And then he goes home, drops her off, and then he's like
Obsesses.
obsessed with her. So he
The
tells him,
awful.
go on.
See, that's the thing. This is the same. Sorry. The same sort of scene could have been portrayed in a completely different way in a completely different film, which is somebody agonizing over when and they can call somebody. You know what I mean? I mean that portrayed in a completely different way, but this way it was a bit like, oh come on, man, give yourself some dignity, give it a rest. Shall I ring her? I'm looking at the phone. I'm gonna grab it. And then of course this is the first time we get a little bit of a insight into what Asami is really about.
Well, so his friend, the film producer, says, "Do me a favor. Look, you're rushing into this whole thing a little bit too quick. Just wait a few days before you call her back." And so then it cuts to her in her apartment, waiting by the phone, and there's nothing in her apartment. She's like sat down. Her apartment is completely bare bones, and then there's a weird, what looks like a body in a sack next to the phone. And that's the first instance. I'm sure that's about 50 minutes into the film where you're like, oh,
A man sack.
this is like ominous now. Like it suddenly got this sort of injection of dread. Judge
Yeah,
dread.
you're like Judge Dredd just kicks the fucking door in. He comes in, puts a bullet in her head, film's over. So this is so we see the man bag, the ban of
The man
the bag
sack.
of man. Well, possibly a man, you know. And she looks like she's waiting for a phone call. She's hanging on for a phone call. Just pick up the phone.
So she answers the phone. They go on another date, and then she plays it cool. She's like, "Oh, I didn't know. I wasn't expecting to call back. I was, busy doing stuff." But she was actually, we know, she was waiting by the phone for 4 days straight.
Yeah, she was. It's something that Aoyama probably would have loved to have known, and he would have picked the phone up straight away, got on the blower to her. But their dates were quite boring, I thought. They just went in a little cafe, had a little beer, you know.
He asked the questions, she answered. It was very much still like the audition process. Like, didn't seem like they were connecting, not to me anyway.
No, not too much because not long after that, he decides to take her on a little trip. Is that that's not long after that, isn't it?
So he says,
And already he's thinking about proposing.
well, he does. Wait. Oh yeah, no, he's thinking about it, isn't he?
He's thinking about it at this point, and you think, come on, man. No matter how much you're into her, you don't know anything about the man sack she's got knocking about.
She's got a hidden man sack. That's
She's
funny. I
got a
don't know
hidden
if that was
man
like
sack.
a again, was that like a inside joke from the director? Like it feels like it could be a bit of a joke there.
Possibly. Where
Just
as your man is your man sack
she's got a
hidden
secret man sack
is your man
tucked
sack hidden
away.
right now?
It's tucked away, don't worry.
Yeah, I am naked from the waist down, just in case.
So he is on about proposing to her on this trip, and then she says, "Do you love me? And will you only have eyes for me?" And then he says, "Of course." And then she disappears. The morning after, she's gone, and he can't get hold of her, no matter what he does. And then
Well,
this, and then, go on.
just before she does strip down to her nudies, and it looks like they're gonna have a little bit of fun time, and that's when he kind of like, does he just fall asleep on the job and then wake up and she's gone?
Well, I don't know because I feel like we skip a bit of time that
Yeah,
could be at the end. I'm not completely sure how.
this is where I think as the film progresses, it starts to get a little bit disjointed in terms of the sort of the narrative goes a bit non-linear. Like things kind of like seem to jump forward a little bit, and there's some scenes that we end up returning to, almost like filling in the gaps. So
And this
they're
is
like
by
some date
design as
scenes.
well, so it's not like goofs. Like
No.
it's designed to sort of unravel your mind as you watch it, but
Yeah,
it's
because
effective.
there are some parts of the dates that we don't necessarily see that later on, as things start to unravel a bit, we kind of come back and fill in the gaps with these extra little bits today, which is good because it kind of gives, it's weird because it kind of gives context to some of the actions of the characters at this point. But at the same time, you're like, well, if you knew that, why did you
carry on
the way you did?
Yeah, so there's some things in this that don't really make much sense to me, and I'll ask you about them when we get to that bit. But so he starts investigating these stories that she told him. She told him she worked at a bar. So he went to the bar. Turns out it's been closed for months or something. I can't remember how long he said. The guy
is it stonefish or something?
Yeah. The main bartender or the head chef or whatever, he's been missing. But they found a severed tongue and I think some fingers or something like that.
And an ear, I believe. What I quite like is when he said the building was tilted.
Yeah.
And so some blood, it's sort of like when the body was found, some blood was like coming out from under the door.
Yeah.
I found that really cool, like a really cool visual of a building, because you said it was really old. This was one of the guys who lived in the building. And it was tilted, and when the body was found, some blood.
And then it cuts to this, like, it like cuts to like a tongue, like flapping. It's really weird, that bit, like the sound effects are so gross. It's like a little fish like slapping away on the floor, but it's a severed tongue.
And the main character, Aoyama, sort of reacts really suddenly to this, what you assume is like a vision he's had. He's like,
yeah. So then the film, it really starts to like go bonkers, banana bonkers. And he goes to the ballet school where she said she studied ballet. And there's this guy there just playing piano, this crazy guy in a wheelchair who's got prosthetic legs. And I really don't understand that character, like...
Yeah, what's going on with those prosthetic legs as well? Because they seem to have, like, sort of flat bits on the bottom, like he's a Sabutio player or something.
It's like escaped from the board, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, no, I've lost that one. Where's he gone? He's ended up in Audition, hasn't he? Playing a part of that dude.
I wonder if he gets home and he has to slot himself into the fixed position for the night.
If someone comes up and flicks him from behind, fuck, God, Jesus, not again, God's sake.
So this dude provides some
sort of backstory for
because I just remember talking nonsense and
he's talking a load of muck, wasn't he? But at this point we kind of got some more flashbacks of him burning Asami when she was a child, sort of like on the inside of her thigh, burning her with what was it, something hot on the inside of her leg.
Yeah, he's got all these metal sticks that he presses against the skin.
Yeah. So it looked like he was like Asami's abuser or possibly, but the way he kind of talks about her is as if she's like a mythical being almost like he's in love with her as well. In love with her and obsessed with her at the same time.
I do wonder if, I'm pretty sure she would have took his legs off, but it doesn't really tell us about that.
No, it doesn't, but that's the thing. It doesn't tell us exactly what happened, but just by seeing him having prosthetic legs and then seeing what happens at the end of the film, it's a nice little sort of callback for, obviously she had his bloody legs off as well, didn't she? Leave the legs out of it. Do a nice kneecap in.
Yeah.
Or something. Or maybe like pull some teeth out of with a pair of pliers. No, leave the feet out of it.
So this is where the film's really ramping up towards its end. So whilst he's out, I'm not too sure if it's this soon, but whilst he's out, we get a classic POV of Asami in his house, looking around, fishing around, and then she sees a picture of his ex-wife, and then we assume that the gloves are off at that point. You said you only love me, but you clearly love
a dead wife as well.
Yeah.
How dare you love a dead wife?
Yeah. So then, this is when it goes so crazy around this point. So, what's his flavor gets home. He has his nightly whiskey, and then he starts to seize up and starts to like become paralyzed, and he falls over. and then it cuts to black before he slams his head on the floor. And then this is when it just gets absolutely bonkers. This is when it turns, because this is very, I mean, it's still kind of disconcerting, but it's still a straight, pretty straightforward narrative to that point. But then it becomes a proper Lynchian nightmare at this point, because it's like, so, I mean, it cuts to her apartment, which I don't understand, because how is he, because he's in her apartment.
Yeah, yeah. So it's almost like a flashback of sorts, but then he's there, because he doesn't necessarily take part in what happens in this flashback. He does look like he's an observer. So it is almost like somehow, for some reason, this is a flashback that's filling in the blanks, but he's being put there as if it represents his realization of what she truly is.
Yeah, but...
Even though he...
So... Okay, so this is where we're in her apartment. There's the man sack again. And this time, the man inside the sack climbs out. and he's missing fingers. He's missing a tongue. I think he's missing a leg or something. But we're seeing this story through the eyes of Shigharu. What's his first name or surname? Asami. No.
Aoyama. I like it. Sugar Daddy, if what you called him then.
Sugar Daddy. Yeah.
It's a good old Let's just call him Sugar Daddy, because yeah, to be honest, that's pretty much what he wants to be. He wants to be Asami's Sugar Daddy.
So we're seeing it through his perspective. This film, this nightmare. He's, as far as we know, he's not been to Asami's apartment. So how does he know what the man in the sack looks like?
Exactly. This is where it's kind of like, that's what I got from it. It wasn't a literal thing. Yeah. It was kind of some sort of flashback slash dream sequence that was filling in, that was sort of confirming Asami's past to him, I guess. Kind of like from where he'd kind of been picking up the pieces,
yeah,
from going to a place of work and to the ballet school.
Yeah.
This was kind of like the realization for him that she was a couple of sandwiches short of a picnic.
She devil. So the man in the sack climbs out, and then he's hungry, apparently, and he's like murmuring for food, and then Asami throws up into a dog bowl and feeds it to him, and he's like lapping it up. Like, it's gross. Like, it really is gross.
Yeah. I mean, there wasn't much consistency to that sick over, really. I mean, it was like milk.
It was like greenish milk, wasn't it?
Greenish milk. I don't know how much you love milk, Luke, and I'm sure
you're that's how I drink it, from a dog bowl on the floor.
It's not been regurgitated, has it?
Murmuring, thank you. Thank you.
It's not been regurgitated usually, has it? No.
Not normally, no.
Not normally, okay, occasionally.
No, occasionally. I have to, you know, spit out the chewy bits. And so... I don't know.
So it looks like this, the man bag, yes, man sack guy, is one of her victims.
Yeah.
Probably someone that has become infatuated with her at some point, and she's obviously been continuing this. She's obviously a serial killer. She's been since leaving the ballet school. She's after having ballet teachers' feet off. She's been continuing this reign of foot terror, and having people's limbs off who become infatuated with her. But she seems obviously she's quite damaged.
Yeah.
And because of that, she might possibly hate men because she's been abused at some point. So she's getting her revenge on the old men.
Yeah, on the old men.
On the old men.
And then this is still in the nightmare sequence. She kills the ballet teacher. She like saws his head off with the fishing wire type thing.
What kind of wire is this? Because
I thought
piano wire. And then I read somewhere else it was like butcher's wire, and now you said fishing wire, so...
I only said fishing wire because that's like what you normally use to... That's like what hitmen use, isn't it, to strangle people. But it's not that, I don't think.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought the strongest of all the wires was piano wire, but you know, I might be completely off on that. I'm sure it was something else.
But it looked like it was barbed, do you know what I mean? So it looked like it was... Like had little knife points, jagged edges on it, like teeth on it. So maybe I just embellished that bit. I don't know. But so all this happens, and then he suddenly wakes up again. But he's on the carpet and he's paralyzed. He can't move. And then he sees the dog is dead. We didn't mention the dog before, but the dog's dead.
Yeah. I had a little dog. What was the dog's name? Oh, yeah,
I
he
want to
had a
say
nice.
Sang or something like that.
I don't remember. But yeah, apparently in one cut of the film or some deleted scenes, there was a scene of her murdering a dog. I don't know
Yeah,
how she
I
did
didn't need to
it.
see
I
that.
don't.
Yeah.
I kind of wish. No, of course not. Well, I don't
Yeah.
need to see either. Look, horrible, isn't it?
Yeah. So then this is the famous torture scene. So she's got like a leather apron on and like these like very
She
like
got those.
stylized
She
sort
got
of.
those long arm gloves,
Yeah.
whatever they're called. The ones that I've only ever seen people wear when they stick their hand up a cow's ass. Don't ask me why. Don't ask me why I've seen that.
Yeah. No, I know what you
But
mean, yeah.
yeah, I don't know if she was gonna, if she just, if she'd even just done
This
that.
torture scene was it's gonna get pretty gruesome if you put like the gloves on to go up a cow's ass
Yeah, I'll be like, oh, just kill me,
Yeah.
just kill me, please. If that hand and arm is going anywhere,
Just starts lubing it up. Okay,
and you're
so
paralyzed, I'll be like, just get, have both my feet off, have them off right now,
and
get
that's when she
away.
changed her mind. She's like, okay, we'll do the feet then.
Yeah.
But first
I'm
she
not
does
into the
the
feet.
she does so she gets out these needles and then she starts piercing his like ribs and she says, this is the most painful part in his body or something. And then there's that famous line, well, famous to me now, is that kitty 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 thing where she's going deeper, deeper, deeper. And the guy's screaming, and then she sticks some needles in his eyes, and
Yeah,
then,
this bit was kind of like POV when she was putting the needles in his eyes, wasn't it? So she was kind of
yeah,
like reaching right in, sticking the old needlies straight in the eyeball, and I was a bit like, oh, I felt like I was cutting onions. My eyes were like, oh God. Yeah, that
so
was pretty gruesome.
I think one of the reasons this torture scene is quite difficult to watch is because we know that the main guy is actually pretty, although like I do feel like the film is trying to say something in terms of men's view of women, I do feel like he's a very likable character. Like he's a very nice guy. There's nothing wrong with him particularly.
Yeah, I mean, it's also like the film tries to like approach misogyny in a
Yeah.
way that, like, if this guy was like a much more of a bastard, like it would be almost that Asami would be seen as like a heroine
Yeah.
as such. Like if
Yeah.
he was just like, I don't know, 20% more bastard, this would probably be like one of those, it'd be like a really good revenge film.
Yeah.
But because he's, he's quite nice and he seems a little bit he's a bit of a puppy dog himself, isn't he? He kind of falls for her pretty quickly. He's a widower.
Yeah.
He don't deserve all this. Give him a
Yeah.
break.
Well, that's what I was thinking. So I did think the same thing. Like, I feel like he is an emotionally pleasant guy who we, we respond to. We like him. We want him to win, basically, to find love and be happy in his family again. He's a nice guy. He's a good dad and all this stuff. But the film is very much trying to. I think it's trying to say it's going to be a play against misogyny. And I think the reason. If he did make it more of a revenge thing and make the guy a bastard, it would cheapen the film and it wouldn't be quite as effective as it is.
That's a good point, definitely.
So then then she has his legs off. Well, feet.
Yeah.
But so she this is it's gruesome, really is. Like she ties the ankle bracelet on, cankle bracelet, and then she gets the fishing wire or whatever it is, and then she saws the leg, the foot off. I mean, you really do see it. Like the effects on that are so intense.
Yeah. It looks like a foot. It looks like a real foot, without a doubt.
Yeah,
Like
yeah.
there's a bit where she sort of I think it's when she's just I think it's when she changes foot
Yeah,
or
I know what you
something. But
mean. Yeah.
the foot kind of moves a bit, and then she starts sort of going at it with the old piano wire, fishing wire stuff. And
Yeah.
it's really like she's really giving it some. It's not like just a little bit of, oh, I'm gonna have this foot off. It's really like shh, shh.
Yeah, oh,
And
is that the sound and stuff? Yeah, it's horrible.
she's an expert. She's done it many times.
Yeah, and then when she switches over to the other, and she loves it. She's like really enjoying it.
Oh
And then
yeah.
when she switches over to the other foot, she just lobs the severed foot against the patio window.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, what you get from this is that A, she's an expert. She's clearly done this exact torture sequence so much that it means absolutely nothing to her now. There's no There's no horrific nature of it at all. It's as easy to her as making a sandwich.
Yeah.
She's just making a lovely foot sandwich. She's just having the foot off, and then this was, I think, the use of sound, use of visuals was, I don't think there was any music at all during the during the torture sequence. There was nothing.
I don't remember much music. In most of that final sequence, there's music all the way throughout the film. There's like lots of piano, pleasant piano stuff, and then during the final torture sequence, there isn't much of anything.
No,
it's like this is what you've been living in a dream world for so long. It's all been nice and romantic, but this is reality now.
This is reality, basically. Yeah. If you're misogynistic, even slightly, even slightly, or if you love your dead wife, for God's sake, let her go. Yeah. Then you're gonna have your feet are coming off.
They're just coming off. Yeah.
You're gonna have to live the rest of your life as a Sabutier man. I'm sorry. you're gonna have to come to terms with it.
I bet she's got a whole football team, 11 aside, of Sabutier men at home.
She just like gets a big green frag. It's right there, guys. Come on, we're recreating the 1996 FA Cup final. Yeah. Man United versus Liverpool. Which one are you gonna be, Eric Cantona? Oh, me.
And then she kicks him in the ass to slide towards
She gets the long insemination glove on, whatever it is.
Yeah.
It goes, right, if you don't score the winning goal, this is going right up your arse.
Yeah. Right up your arse. So then Shigahike, I think his name is, the son arrives home from his date or whatever he's been up to.
Yeah, can we talk? He's a bit of a ladies' man, this guy, isn't he?
He is, yeah.
A little bit of a ladies' man. Obviously, he's forced his dad to get back out on the dating scene, but he's leading by example.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's on a date with someone. There's a few little winks between father and son. Oh, he's doing all right, he's sunshine. Oh, yeah. Don't forget to walk her home.
Yeah, and then it cuts to more nightmare stuff, I think, at that point. Does that cut back to the hotel where he proposed?
I think so.
And they're like, okay, we're going to get married. And then it cuts back again. So this is the end of the film, basically. She chases the sun. She's like, okay, I've got my spray. Don't know what the spray is.
Lynx Africa.
Lynx Africa. You stinky boy.
Come back here. Yeah. £3. I've got you to finish for Christmas. Come on, you haven't even used it.
Yeah. She's like... So she's trying to spray him, and then she chases him up the stairs, and she's getting him right in the face with this Lynx Africa spray. And he's like, I hate this smell. And he boots her down the stairs.
he delivers. It's quite ironic that she was eventually undone by a foot.
You know? Yeah, that's a good point.
She seems to have disregard for feet all over, but it's a foot that eventually kicks her down the stairs and breaks her neck, snaps her neck like a... like a twiglet.
Yeah, she was. You could say she was defeated.
there we go. Yeah. That was a good one, wasn't it?
And then, so she's dying with a broken neck on the floor. He's bleeding out of his foot, and they're like looking at each other, kind of longingly, which is a bit of a weird shot.
He's got these weird fake eyelashes in at this point, the needles.
Yeah. Like twinkling them, looking all pretty like, and then it cuts to fades to black, and that's the end.
Yeah,
of
well, she's at this point. She says the same. She says a line from earlier in the film where she says that she didn't think she'd ever see him again, or she says she'd been waiting for him to call. She says something like that, doesn't she? When she's dying.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much it. And then we assume, Sugar Daddy does survive.
Yeah.
He doesn't die from foot bleeding out.
And he holds the next round of auditions.
Yeah. You're through to boot camp. Well done.
Yeah. I wonder what the final film turned out like.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I wonder what the live shows were like.
Yeah. No, it's good.
And then can we just briefly talk about the end credits song?
What was the end credits song?
The end credits song. Well, I need to find it. We need to put it in the show notes or something. But the end credits song to Audition is the most happy-go-lucky Japanese pop song ever, and it just completely made me go, "What is going on?"
Yeah,
I don't know what the lyrics are. Whether they're about, you know, feet coming off, man sacks, human Studio squads, you know, it must have
Tongues
been terrible.
flapping around on the floor.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly.
And so, I mean, I think it was a great film. I don't know if I'd watch it again anytime soon because it was quite that first 60 minutes. Cause I remember looking at it thinking, nothing horrible's happened yet, and it's 60 minutes, an hour into the film. But it's all just building up to that final drink of whiskey that he takes.
Exactly, but it just makes films like this just make those moments feel so much more impactful and so much more worth it, because you feel like you've been on the journey with the character. You've kind of like say for example, if the film started and we immediately saw her torturing someone, or we immediately saw her that she was a psychopath, I don't think it'd have nearly half the impact it did. So I
I
think the
think,
film.
yeah, I think you're right. I think if they started at that sort of high volume of violence, it immediately has nowhere left to go. But the fact that it starts off so low on the sort of, I wasn't expecting, you don't expect any violence from the music or the tone from the first hour, and then it suddenly just sort of like kicks into gear right in the last half an hour.
Exactly. And it is another, as I said at the start, it is essentially not really a horror film. It's just a psychological thriller with a torture sequence.
Yeah, that's right. The torture sequence itself is horror, and the whole tongue thing and the man in the sack and the nightmare sequences for me were quite horrible. But it's not a straight up horror, is it? Not really. It's a genre bender.
It's a genre bender, exactly, not a gender bender, a genre bender. And this is, and even though we, when we watch four now, I think three out of four so far have been not straight up horror films. So I think we kind of know the way this list is going to go. I think there are going to be a lot. There are going to be a lot of experiences like this, I think.
I think it would be the films that define horror, like The Evil Dead, or define horror cliches and genre cliches, like The Evil Dead and some of the films later on the list. But then there'll also be the films on the opposite side of the spectrum, which are not pure horror.
Films that like the film hipsters have decided to include in the Empire top 50 horror film lists, you know, like I keep expecting somewhere there to be like a completely random one just thrown in out of nowhere, like A Bug's Life or something. Oh, that was horrible, that bit when it towards the with the bird.
There is a yeah. There is some horror in A Bug's Life. I seem to remember. Doesn't he like threaten to like crush their stamp on their skull? Do you know what I mean? The locust guy.
Who does the
Yeah, I
voice of
know.
that
I was just
locust guy?
thinking that is his name.
It's Kevin Spacey.
No, it's not Kevin
It's Kevin.
Spacey. No, it's
It's
not.
not.
No, it's the guy from Videodrome, and I really can't remember his name. James Woods.
That's right. That's right. Why
Yeah.
did I say Kevin Spacey?
Because Kevin Spacey is a great actor, and he plays a lot of roles. You're hedging your bets, basically. It's Kevin Spacey. It probably is.
Exactly. I think it was Kevin Spacey. It's James Woods. Yeah. I'm gonna go watch A Bug's Life.
But
And I'm going to watch.
that's the next on the list.
That's next. Oh, thank God. I've been waiting forever. Giant bird.
So, jump scares. I don't think I counted any particularly jumpy scares. I think there might have been one with the man sack suddenly rolling and springing to life.
Yeah, there were a
But
couple of like unnerving little cuts where we saw, well, initially where we saw the tongue and the, you know, a couple of little bits like that and the man sack man balls, whatever. But other than that, no jump scares, which I like. You know,
I like too, yeah.
got no time for jump scares.
I prefer the building dread. I think it sticks with you longer. Shit your pants moments. I just think that whole torture scene and some of the nightmare sequences were.
Depends how you are with those torture porn sequences, but yeah, it was a bit of a shit your pants moment. It's a bit of like can't really quite look, but also have to watch car crash type thing. So yeah, that was pretty horrible.
Trivia. So I've got some trivia for you. Is this true trivia or false trivia? The dog in the film is referred to as a boy, but is actually a female.
Oh Jesus! This is going to unravel time and space for me if this is true.
Well, okay. So this one, it's not on any website, but I think, being I've grown up around dogs, they call it a boy, but the dog has teats. It's got eight teats, and
Ah,
so it looks like a recently pregnant female. So I was like, that's not a boy.
That's incredibly, like, you've really noticed that. Not only have you noticed as a girl, but you've counted the teats.
Well, I mean, they've all got 18.
They've all got 18. Yeah, we're like, one, two, three. Oh, paws. Yeah. One, two, eight.
Four paws, eight teats. Yeah. No, they were, they've all got the same amount of teats, dude. okay, so
clearly I don't know enough.
Number two, but you were right on that one. If you're following my idea, I think I'm right about that as well. Okay, so the vomit that the man sack eats, the man from the sack eats, is real vomit.
Is real vomit? What? Yeah. Just like the cameraman did?
No, the Asami did. She's a method actress, and she was like, "I'm only doing this if it's a real vomit."
No, that's too far. No, false.
Well, apparently it's true.
Jesus.
It doesn't sound true. It sounds kind of something that they would make up as a way to sort of spin them some marketing.
Yeah. Because if you're this dude in the man sack,
yeah.
I mean, it's not really a speaking part. It kind of is.
Yeah.
You're in like a scene, unless you're in a man sack for the rest of the time. I can't imagine you're getting that much, you know.
His character for that one.
For this next sequence, she's going to be sick in a bowl, and you've got to eat it.
Also,
I want my paycheck.
In the trivia, it says that she's the method actress. So what, is she like, well, I'm only doing this scene if he eats my sick? Like, why does she have to eat her sick?
what weird demand to make.
Yeah, otherwise I'm out. Like, 9 months into filming.
Is that true then?
Well, apparently it's true. It's on the trivia websites.
If I was on that set and she was like, oh, I'm going to be sick for real and someone's going to eat it, I'd be like, oh, for God's sake. For God's sake.
I don't know, like some actresses, you know, they're very demanding for what they want in their rider and that kind of
stuff. So if she was a method actress, she's like, for this scene, I'm actually going to take his foot off because I'm a method actor. No, don't do it. Too bloody late.
Loves it across the, loves the severed foot across the room.
Well, yeah. I'm not even filming for that bit. I have to do the
other one. Do it again. Yeah. Okay, so... Well, I would agree with you on that, but based on IMDb, you got that wrong, I'm afraid. That's the first one you got wrong. The severed tongue that you see squirming in the restaurant was actually a cow tongue.
It was actually a cow's tongue. It looked quite small, actually. I'd say false.
Correct. I just made that one up.
All right. How would they made it move like that? Just electrify it a little bit.
Cow's tongues. This is the next fact. Cow's tongues are... move independently of the cow's head.
Oh, right. For how long after death?
A couple of minutes.
Oh, a couple of minutes. Yeah. Forever. They're powering. Forget about wind turbines and the solar energy.
You just need cow's
tongues. Cow's tongues all lined up, you know, just...
Yeah. Okay, so... in the original screenplay... Aoyama's feet were, both of his feet were dismembered for the torture scene. However, in the script, oh no, sorry. In the original story, the novel, both of the feet were taken off. In the script, no feet were taken off. In the film, the actual, when they filmed it, one foot was taken off. And the director said he was splitting the difference.
Oh, so in the script, no feet were taken off?
No.
And in the book, both feet were taken off.
Yeah,
that kind of makes sense. I'll say that's true.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so I don't know what you got, like, two, didn't really matter too much. But it's interesting.
It doesn't even matter. What's the point in doing these trivia things every week if I'm not going to get some sort of recognition?
Okay, one sec. You got one, two, three.
Two out of what?
Oh, I've got another one to ask as well. So far you've got three out of four. The last one is Quentin Tarantino described it as a true masterpiece if there ever was one.
I've definitely heard him say something about this film before. So I'd say yes, true, sorry.
Cool, yeah, that's true. Four out of five.
Yeah, didn't he mention... this was definitely in a Tarantino list of his favourite films, I think. Don't know if it's like his top 10 films or like his top 10 films of the last 20 years or something. You know, he does a lot of crazy lists. He likes some... some films that you wouldn't necessarily think he would like.
Yeah.
I mean, I can kind of understand
films that
this,
aren't Tarantino films. I kind of assume he'd only like his own films.
He doesn't... He hates all non-Tarantino films, yeah. Apparently. But one of his favorite films recently, he really loves It Follows. He says it's like he
that's
said it's
later,
like the most.
That's later on this list.
Oh, we get to watch it again, do we?
Yeah.
Hell yeah! I love that film.
Yeah, it's great. So that's it. So we just need to grade the film. I'll let you go first because I don't want to go first.
I'll probably give it a B, I think, because I definitely enjoyed it. It definitely got under my skin. I liked a lot of the visuals, I liked the music, I liked a lot of the edits. It felt like a well-directed, well-acted, good... I was about to say good fun, but was it good fun? I don't think it was good fun.
No, even like the sort of happy bits weren't particularly fun to watch.
No, it's just, but it's one of those films that you experience the whole way. You feel the roller coaster of emotions that eventually ends with something terrible and painful. Yeah. So yeah, I give it a B. I'm probably maybe a B minus because I think.
Okay.
Yeah, a B minus.
Well, I've given it a B. I think. I would probably actually maybe give it a B plus. The more I think about it, the more I realize sort of how well intended each of the elements are in the film. Like there doesn't seem to be much like meandering. Like all the stylistic choices are very well put together. I feel like the underlying message, if there is one, like is like mature, and I feel like it is a very well put together film. And that last scene is probably, I'm probably going to remember it for like, you know, for the rest of my life. Like it really is that effective.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's going to be a great scene to talk about as well. It's really well directed for a guy who I've noticed has directed a hell of a lot of films.
Well,
look at his Wikipedia page.
In the same year he directed this, he directed, I think it was something like 2 made for TV films, as well as, and some sort of TV show as well. So he's like incredibly prolific.
Yeah, I mean, I think direct for feature films, I think he's done almost 100.
And he bakes cakes.
Does he?
I don't know, he just made that up.
Are we still in trivia mode? What's going on?
Yeah. So
he might bake cakes, probably does.
I guess we average that out as a B then. I would not want to watch this again anytime soon, but I really liked it. I really enjoyed the experience, actually, but I found it really effective.
But sometimes it happens with films that you can really appreciate and you really rate, that you feel like, I don't really need to watch that again immediately, because it's like, it was a slog, but not a slog as in, oh, when's this going to be over, but a slog as in, like, it felt like a real challenge to watch without...
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind watching the torture sequence again, but like with somebody who hadn't seen it before, just to see their reaction.
I've just thought we should add a feature to this show where we talk about criticisms, because I would say that first hour doesn't need to be an hour long. Like you could do that in a bit less of that, and I think the torture scene could have taken it to the next level. But
yeah.
Maybe that's just because we've seen a lot
You're
of
sick.
Gore. Yeah, because I'm mentally ill, I would like to see more. Happen there. I just feel like although the foot fiend's good, I just feel like there could have been another level on top of that.
Yeah, I would have liked more montages, because I really enjoyed the montage of the audition sequence. So like at least 3 more montage sequence, maybe like a torture scene montage.
Yeah,
bits of him flying off, like different things happening, his eyelashes going, you know, all that stuff.
If you start seeing the other girls doing it to him. Like sort of flashing. There's lots of things you could have done, but I thought it was good. And
yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true. Because if this film was a take on misogyny, they could have gone a lot of different directions with it.
Yeah.
Because it kind of did just focus on this girl and sort of think, well, she's obviously damaged, so she's the one lashing out at these men, and essentially her anger towards men has gone as far as essentially killing, well, trying to kill. An innocent person, rather than someone who'd wronged her, because he hadn't wronged her at all. Really, he was going to make a lovely life for her. They're gonna have a lovely time.
But again, the men did this to her because her teacher, ballet teacher, used to like jerk one off whilst watching her do ballet. I don't know if you noticed that bit.
Yeah, he rubbed one out, didn't he?
Yeah, and then like talked to him and stuff. Like, so it, because he saw as this sort of object of desire rather than like a real person, like he kind of forced her into that mentally unstable state. But like, yeah, I know what you mean. It could have gone a few ways, but
they could have even returned to his friend, the director dude, and involved him somehow. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe like she got to know the truth of the film from him somehow, and in that way it kind of like set off a chain of events where she ended up torturing him. I don't know.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it? Like, I would be worried about changing too many bits like that, because I do think it's quite subtle, and maybe that's why people like it so much. And because if you have more torture scenes and more stuff happening before, it would negate a little bit of what the
Yeah, well, I've not really got that many complaints. It worked for me.
Yeah, me too. Cool. So I guess that's it for us at the minute. So follow me on Twitter at Luke of Condor with Kate. Follow Ben at Twitter at _
Whoa. Ben _ Errington.
That's the one, yeah.
/ the beauty. No, forget that bit.
So yeah, tweet us what you thought about the film. We'd like to know what you thought.
what's next?
I don't know. Let's have a quick look.
I think it's a Hammer Horror next.
Yeah, it's an older one, isn't it?
Yeah, so we get to go.
Yeah, the first white hair. I remember that much.
Jimmy Savile.
I think I'm thinking of Christopher Lee. The Devil Rides Out, the 1968 film. Actually, it's a Hammer film. Yeah. I've no idea what that is. I've never seen it before, so that would be exciting.
That sounds pretty exciting. How are we going to watch that? We'll have to go to a video shop and pick it out. That'd be fun, wouldn't it?
It might be on Shudder or something. I don't know. Okay, so this show is brought to you by the Story Studio Hawk and Cleaver. Head over to www.hawkandcleaver.com and grab a free book. Also become a patron for early access episodes, bonus content, and heaps of free stuff at patreon.com/hawkandcleaver. Thanks to Acast for hosting the show. Thanks to the listeners. If you enjoyed the show, please give us a 5-star rating, review in iTunes. Remember to hit subscribe. And thanks to my co-host, Ben, for being a real horror dude.
Thank you too, Luke. You're welcome. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Bye.
Goodbye.